But what I want us to learn this morning is, number one, what does that term mean in the first place? Religiously. Restoration. To restore something means to take it back to its original state. Being a history buff, I love some of these shows that are about restoration, where they take various things, whether it's an old car or an old clock or whatever it may be, and they restore it back to its original state. You know? When they do that, they're stripping off all the things that have been done to it by men over the course of that item's history. You know? I watched a very old early motorcycle. I think it was like 1913, something like that. I watched it being restored a while back. And you know, someone had come in at some point and they had painted the bike, so no longer the original color. And they had put a more modern headlight on the bike. And they had changed various other things. And of course, it was now also old and rusted and had been sitting up for decade after decade. And so, to restore that bike, they stripped off all the paint. They took off all the parts that somebody had put on after the fact that was not part of the original design. They replaced them with original parts and restored it to its working state. You know, getting in and tearing up that engine and rebuilding it and all of those things so that the bike would be restored, taking it back to its original state. So, religiously, when you talk about the church and you talk about restoration, you're talking about taking it back to its original state. Our design, our goal, is to not be a man-made church. And if in our practices, if in our doctrine, we teach things that are not the doctrine of Christ, not what was originally given to the church, then we're like that old motorcycle coming along, we're putting different paint on it because we didn't like the color that God put on it, you see. And we're sticking a more modern headlamp on it because we think that would work better. And we're doing all these different things, all of which is making it something that is not original. So that's the restoration concept. And the purpose and the priority in doing that is that only God's church will be saved. He teaches us that over and over again. Now, so we want to be that church, and the way you restore anything, the way you get back to the original, is to take away what man has added, what man has changed about it. Now here's the problem. Restoration is an ongoing process. It is not something that happens at one time and place, and that's all that ever needs to be done in that regard. Because what happens is, if you take that bike, you take it back to that original state, and then you go back to it 50 years later, you know what's happened? Somebody else has come along who didn't like the color, and you thought it looked better with this and that. Maybe they changed the whole purpose of the motorcycle. Maybe they've taken the engine out and used it to power something else, you see. That is the nature of man. So we always need to be going back to the Word of God to restore true worship. That is our goal, because that again is what is acceptable to the Lord. Those the Lord is seeking those who will worship Him in spirit and in truth. Thy word is true, John 17:7. So we go back to the book in almost a literal sense. Not out of any reverence to the book itself, but out of reverence for the God who gave us the book so that we would know His will. Now, one of the problems I have with the Stone Campbell movement, and I'll tell you that right up front, is just that some people develop a mindset that we have to do everything like the Stone Campbell movement did. Yeah. Well, that may be true, but it also may not be true, because we don't have to do everything like the Stone Campbell movement did. We have to do everything like the Lord's church did. I do not practice actions are teach one single thing, because that's what the restoration movement in this country did. There's absolutely nothing that I observe in my spiritual life because that's what the restoration movement did. I do those things because that's what the New Testament church did. And there is a key difference there. It's discouraging to me sometimes when I come across a brother whose mindset is that you know, we're being what was going on in the church of this country, you know, a couple hundred years ago. It's the spirit of them that we see. The thought that our desire is pure milk of the Word without human additives, you see. And so it's an important concept to understand. The other thing that we need to understand is it's become very popular in the church of this country today to sneer at the Stoney Campbell movement, at the restoration era, and to sneer at the idea that we want to be the New Testament church by taking away the man-made things. And we need to address both attitudes. And I think that the simplest way to do that is to once again go back to the Word. Go back to the Word that God Himself has given us to guide us to Him and to keep us in His grace. And so my desire this morning is simply to look at one instance and to make you aware of several others where this restoration has gone on again and again and again and again. See, that's why I say it's an ongoing thing. We're going to look this morning in 2 Kings chapter 22. And I'm going to jump around a couple of other places. But the narrative that we're focusing on is found in 2 Kings 22, 2 Chronicles 34, also gives the same period of history. And this is in the reign of King Josiah. Now, Moses had given those instructions that were read for us for the king to take the book of the law when he became king, to take God's word, and to write out his own personal copy of it so that king, you see, would know the truth about what God's instructions were for his people. The saddest state that can ever befall the people of God is when they lose the knowledge and understanding of His Word, His special revelation to us, because He gave that to us so that we would have the guidelines for following Him, so that we would have that understanding. And so, King Josiah is one of the two young kings that are mentioned in Israel's history. You remember Josiah begins to reign at 8 years old. Joash began to reign at 7 years old. But you know, when Josiah comes to power, he's coming to it at a difficult time. It's hard enough to come to it at 8 years old, isn't it? I remember reading this story when I was about 8 years old. I got excited. I wanted to be king at 8 years old. It didn't work out for me. But I thought about that, you know, a boy king like that. But despite being 8 years old, the bigger problem that he really had was that he was coming into the kingship after 57 years of apostasy. The word apostasy means to fall away. You see, when we quit following Christ's doctrine, we have fallen away from being the Lord's church. We've fallen away from being His disciples. And so, physical Israel back then, and He is leading the kingdom of Judah at this time, God's already bringing judgments against the northern kingdom of Israel. He has to do something about 57 years of apostasy. In fact, if you read this whole section of history, you'll read a great deal about how the temple has been allowed to fall into disrepair. One of the things is he's making sure that the money that's been collected to rebuild the temple, is being turned over to the workmen. So they're getting paid so they can get that done. But that wasn't the worst thing, just the neglect of the building, if you will. The big apostasy was that they had begun to worship idols. They had even erected idols in the temple. One of the other things you'll see is where the king orders them to go in and to remove all of those things. All of the statues, the idols, all the paraphernalia that went along with the idol worship, the shears, all those things, to remove them not only from the temple and from its grounds, but from the entire kingdom, and to burn those things. But that shows you how bad things were when he becomes king. Now he's 16 years or so into his reign when chapter 22 takes place. And so you see him now, he's still very young, he's in his early 20s. But he's trying to address the heart of the issue by destroying the idols and the things connected with it, but there's something lacking. See, anybody else would look at that and say, well, look how sincere he is for God. Look how devoted he is to God. And yes, that would all be true, but he still wasn't pleasing to God. Please recognize that fact. Being sincere about your positions and your beliefs does not make you acceptable to God. The Bible is full of people who were very sincere and who experienced God's judgment. Paul's main charge leveled at Israel in his day was that they had a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. There is a passage that is quoted all the time. In fact, I quoted it a couple of weeks back when I gave the talk over in the Bower Building about our goals and our desires and working toward those. And if you were listening carefully, you might have heard a little caveat I threw in when I quoted it. And I did that quite deliberately because I have a little bit of an axe to grind against the way that passage is used so often. The passage says, where there is no vision, the people perish. And so when you're talking about planning and goals and all those things, that passage is always quoted. The problem is that's a bad translation. Depending on which English Bible you use today, you may have a much better translation because some of the later ones have rectified that problem. While there's some validity to using that passage in that sense that it's normally used, that validity comes from the fact that what it is really saying and what your translation should say, and again, if you have a later one, may say, is where there is no revelation. Because what he's actually talking about in the context of that passage is that without special instruction from God, the people have no idea what to do. In other words, how to be pleasing to God, what is acceptable to the Lord. That's why he had given us his word, and that's why he had given fleshly Israel and those kings of theirs the law of Moses and the first five books of the Bible as we have them. And why he had given those instructions that every king was to sit down and write out his own copy of that so that they would have the knowledge needed to lead God's people. One of the frustrations I have with the modern church, quote unquote, is the responsibilities we load onto our ministry. And the teaching gets buried deeply in those responsibilities. And we want him basically instead to be an elder or a shepherd. And then we wonder why our churches get further and further away from the revelation of God. Well, if your leaders are not spending a lot of time in studying his word, they're not going to lead you closer to God. But if they spend most of their time running around being shepherds, they don't have the time. Ask a minister. Find one you can talk to in a context in which he will not feel prophet said, my people perish for a lack of knowledge. That was a prophet of physical Israel, but it's still true of spiritual Israel. But the good news is, it can always be restored. It has to start, though, with that knowledge base of what God has instructed us to do. Today, we don't want to listen to God's instruction. We want to recognize ourselves and make up our own instruction and then stamp His name on it and call it worship and call it discipleship. But if it's not according to His revelation, then it's not acceptable to Him. It's not pleasing to Him. So here our young king comes in. And he's trying to do the right thing. He's making the effort to rid the country of its idolatry. He's making the effort to physically restore the temple the way it's supposed to be and everything. But then he gains some vision, some revelation. Because after those first 7 verses, he sends one of his servants to take that money to the workmen at the temple. And when that servant gets to the temple, the high priest tells the king's servant, he says, look what I found. You know what he found? He found the book of the law that was supposed to always be in the temple beside the Ark of the Covenant. I'm going to read you a passage from Deuteronomy chapter 31. And again, as they're getting ready to go in and possess the land, this is part of the instruction. And in 31, beginning in verse 26, Moses said, when Moses finished writing the words of the law in the book, they put it in the complete thing in the book. Moses commanded the Levites who carried the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, saying, verse 26, take this book of the law and place it beside the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God, that it may remain there as a witness against you. So God has instructed Moses to have them put a copy of his word next to the Ark of the Covenant, and he told Moses to do that because they need that witness. See, they need that continual instruction. Moses goes on to say very particularly, verse 27, for I know your rebellion and your stubbornness. Behold, while I am still alive with you today, you have been rebellious against the Lord. How much more than after my death? I always love that speech. Poor Moses. He's given his life to trying to lead these people. He's been the source of all those wonders, the conduit for all those miracles in the 10 plagues and all the red crossing the Red Sea and all the ones for all that time in the wilderness. And they had kicked and fussed and screamed against him all the way. And so as he knows he's going to die, he says, you make sure you put a copy of the Word of God next to the Ark of the Covenant, because I know you. Look how bad you behaved while I was still alive, while I was still with you here. I know what's going to happen when I'm gone. You're going to change things. See, you're going to rebel against God's instruction. You're going to do things the way you want to do those things. And so this book of the law will always be there. One of the things that disturbs me today is the modern interpretation of our passage back there in 22, and that's why I read this one to you from Deuteronomy 31. Because today, the end thing to say about what was actually found is it wasn't the Pentateuch. It wasn't even the book of Deuteronomy. It was a sentence or two from Deuteronomy that was found. And they say that because they've already tried to tell us that the book didn't exist at that time, you see. So everything is reinterpreted in light of their personal agenda to try and teach that the Word of God didn't exist in that period of time, that it was written by a priest much later. But there are numerous passages that show us very clearly, implicitly, and overtly that this book did exist, and that God had given it to him, and that kings prior to Josiah had it. Another passage I wrote is in Deuteronomy 17. Deuteronomy 17, not sorry, that's the one I had to Wesley, it was. It's in 2 Chronicles 17. 2 Chronicles 17. This is Jehoshaphat and his attempt at restoration, at taking the worship of God back to the original, back to where it needs to be. And if you look there in verse 7 of 2 Chronicles 17, then in the third year of his reign, he sent his officials, Beniel, Obadiah, Zechariah, Nathaniel, Micaiah, to teach. Underline that. He didn't send them to hold their hand. He didn't send them to do all these physical things for them. He sent them to teach. What were they to teach in the cities of Judah? Well, let's look at who he sends with them and see what that's important. With them, the Levites, Shimei, Nethaniah, Zebadiah, Ashiel, Shemaroth, Jephunneh, Adonijah, Abijah, and Tabadonijah, the Levites. And with them, Elishama and Jehoram, the priests. These are the people that God has given the responsibility to of teaching his word. And so as Jehoshaphat is trying to restore the true religion of the one true God, he sends the teachers with the word of the Lord. Look at verse 9. They taught in Judah, having the book of the law of the Lord with them. That's not just a passage out of Deuteronomy. That's not even just a book of Deuteronomy. That's the entire Pentateuch. And so they taught in Judah, having the book of the Lord, of the law of the Lord with them, and they went throughout all the cities of Judah and taught among the people. What is necessary for restoration? It's God's special revelation. It's knowledge of his instruction. It's his divine guidance and wisdom in how we are to approach him and how we are to live our lives in service to him. And throughout history, men have been able to go back to restore to that original worship by following the words of God that are contained in the Bible. And so Jehoshaphat did that. And you go back to 2 Kings 22, when the word of God is read to young King Josiah, who has done so much already in his reign to try and restore the worship of the true God. And it was made these other reform efforts we've talked about. But look at what he never knew. Verse 8 there in 2 Kings 22 says, then Hilkiah the high priest said to Shaphan the scribe, I have found the book of the law in the house of the Lord. And Hilkiah gave the book to Shaphan, and don't miss this, because this is where the rubber meets the road, who read it. The book of the Lord doesn't do any good collecting dust on your coffee table. It doesn't do any good until it is open and it is read. That's where instruction comes from. I know that my colleagues get tired of me hearing me say it, but I'm not going to quit saying it. I'm tired of our preachers spending more time reading books written by each other than the book of the Lord. Yes, there's value in reading some of those books, but it pales in comparison to the value of reading the book. And you see, when we read each other's books and ignore the Lord's books, that's when we start getting further and further away from God's revelation. That's when we're in need of restoration. We're in need of going back. And so the king, Josiah here, has sent his servant. The servant reads the book, verse 9. Shaphan the scribe came to the king and brought back word to the king and said, your servants have done as you ordered. That all applies to the physical work on the temple. Verse 10 says, moreover, Shaphan the scribe told the king, saying, Hilkiah the priest has given me a book. And Shaphan read it in the presence of the king. You see, when Shaphan first gets it and he reads it, he knows right away they haven't been following God. I imagine he marked the appropriate passages. Because notice the first thing that happens after he has read it, he doesn't give it to the king to read it himself yet. He first reads it himself to the king. Like any good preacher, I'm sure he's reading those things to the king that he has seen they are not doing. You see? And so, verse 11, when the king heard the words of the book of the law, because he had been sincere, he had been devout, and he had done a lot of good things, and yet he wasn't right with God because he didn't know what God's instructions were. And so he tears his clothes, verse 12, the king commanded him to hide a priest, and hire him the son of Shaphan, Achabor the son of Micaiah, and Shaphan the scribe, and Zion the king's servant said, go inquire of the Lord for me and all the people and all Judah concerning the words of this book. There's a prophetess who is without any other mention in the Bible, so I can't tell you anything else about her. But she is the only person, and isn't that a sad commentary? She is the only person in the area that they know to have revelation. And so the king sends these servants to her to find out God's instructions. Her name is Huldah. And in verse 14, Hilkiah the priest and all of the servants there, they get to her home in Jerusalem. And this is what she says to them, verse 15. Thus says the Lord God of Israel, tell the man who sent you to me, thus says the Lord. And again, you see, there's the criteria. It's not thus says Chris. It's not thus says Toby. It's not thus said the elder. And it's not thus said whoever is the most popular dynamic writer and speaker out there currently. It's what the Lord says. That's what matters. And if it doesn't have a thus says the Lord behind it, it's a very limited value because it's human in origin instead of divine in origin. And so the Lord is going to bring evil on Judah. This is going to be the captivity that we've been studying in our Wednesday night class. He'll bring evil on this place and on its inhabitants, even all the words of the book which the king of Judah has read. You see, another thing indicating the larger presence of the full book of God, not just a single passage. The passages are there that speak of the curses that God also promised if they didn't obey him. I hear a lot of people these days laying all kinds of claims to blessings from God. Those same people never seem to mention the curse. So that they're applying the blessings when it's not according to what God said he would bless. And then they're neglecting any negative aspect that they refer to. I always love that when preachers tell me, well, what are those negative aspects? If it's part of the revelation of God and you avoid it, you're avoiding the word of the Lord. And so what the king finds out basically is that because of his efforts and because of his grief when he learns he's not obeying God, God is going to not bring the judgment against Judah in King Josiah's life. But he is going to still bring the promised judgment against Judah. The captivity, the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple, it's all still going to happen because of the sins of his forefathers, the prior king, because of those 57 years of apostasy and on and on and on. Lord willing, next week we're going to look at the specific incident that basically started the slide that led to the captivity. But I wanted us to focus this morning on this one scene of restoration. Because what continues to take place there, if you go down and you read 23, and if you read the passages in Chronicles, is when he hears the revelation, he begins to obey. And he teaches others to obey. And he leads the nation under him into a right relationship with God. You see, any time that we get away from God, we can always come back to him. But we have to come back to him in truth. We have to come back to him according to knowledge of his revelation, not our own, you see. But it's a process that has happened, who knows how many times. One of the things that I have, Cody, if you've never done this, or seen any of this material, let me know, and I'll take you through it on my computer. But one of the things that I've done through the years, because of some of these misleading statements I hear about the restoration, and I hear people say, you know, we're just a denomination that was started by Alexander Campbell and things like that. Well, if you do things because Campbell said them, that's a true statement. But it's a horrible, hellish lie if you do things because God said it. And I tremble when I hear my brethren make those kinds of statements. I can't understand. You're literally blaspheming God. You're literally blaspheming the Lord's church. You're literally blaspheming the Lord's people. And yet they say it right out all the time. Don't give any thoughts. All that is ever necessary is for humble hearts to seek God through His revelation, through His instructions. And so, Josiah could do it. Jehoshaphat could do it. We just saw Ezra and Nehemiah do it in another generation. Alexander Campbell could do it. And we can do it. But we have to understand what the term really means. And we have to understand the priority of ensuring that we do follow God and not anything. If you're here today and you've never obeyed the Word of God regarding your personal salvation, you can go out here today, you can turn on your television, you can probably hear half a dozen different ways to obtain quote-unquote salvation. How is that possible? It's because if you don't base it on the Word of God, then you get into the realm of opinion, and there are always various opinions. But the Lord made it very simple and very straightforward. He that believeth and is baptized will be saved. He that believeth not will be saved. Over and over in the book of Acts, we read all the stories of conversion. It always comes down to belief in Jesus, the Son of God, to repentance for our sin, to a willingness to confess Him as Lord, and then a baptism in water to come up a new creature, having come into contact with the blood of Christ. If you haven't done that today, you need to understand that that's what you need to be right with God. And as a people, what we need to understand is that we always need